Well, watching this Tory psychodrama from the sidelines are the opposition parties. And we're joined by two of their representatives now. Stephen Kinnock is the Labour MP for Aberavon. Jonathan Edwards is Plaid Cymru MP for Carmarthen East and Dyneford. Good morning, both.
Good morning.
Stephen, you've been very firm against the idea of another referendum, people's vote, whatever we want to call it. Can I put a point to you that Tom Watson puts in The Observer today? He says polls show Labour have been losing up to four times more voters to parties giving full backing to a people's vote other than Farage. The campaign to change the policy begins now. What do you make of that argument?
The fundamental challenge with the argument for a people's vote is nobody's really explained how to get there. I think if we really wanted to have a second referendum, we should have voted for the withdrawal agreement bill at second reading, because there was an opportunity then at committee stage to have a set piece debate and vote on having a second referendum. By not supporting the withdrawal agreement bill, we've ended up putting the fate of the country in 120,000 hard-line, hard-right no dealers who will elect a hard-line, hard-right prime minister. So I think we've actually, because of the polarization in parliament and everybody staying in their own little camp there, we've ended up putting the country on the brink of crashing out of the European Union without a deal.
I'll take a step back, if I may, Stephen, first of all, about how you might get there, that question, which is a totally valid question. But do you agree with Tom Watson that the time has come now for Labour to get off the fence and to fully support what we could call a Remain position, if you like, that there should be a second referendum and that the Labour Party would argue for Remain in that referendum?
Well, I agree with the old maxim of Nye Bevan, that if you stand in the middle of the road, you get run over. I think we had a clear...
And that's what's likely to happen tonight, isn't
yes,
it, when those
yeah.
votes are counted?
Yes, that is what will happen. And I think up until party conference last year, we had a clear position, which was we were a party that wanted to honour the referendum, but recognised it was a very close result, and therefore we should leave the European Union with a very strong and close deal in terms of frictionless trade with 500 million consumers on our doorstep. And I think that was a clear and coherent position. Once we started moving sort of in a bit of a mealy-mouthed way towards a second referendum without a full-throated commitment to it, that's when you end up muddying the waters and you have an unclear position, and that means we're going to have a terrible result in these Euro elections.
So you should either have stuck to the original position or should have moved wholeheartedly to the other position rather than trying to straddle the fence, as it were.
Yes, that is my view.
Jonathan Edwards, what do you make of Stephen Kinnock's point there that if you really wanted a people's vote, second referendum, third referendum, whatever we call it, then you should have supported Theresa May's deal?
Well, we never got to the stage whereby the withdrawal bill was brought before Parliament, because, of course, the Prime Minister lost on what she was proposing on three occasions, and, of course, has fallen before she got to present the bill.
But hang on, had you and others signalled that you would support the withdrawal bill, the withdrawal bill would have been put to Parliament?
Well, if, you know, what the Prime Minister proposed, of course, in her speech last week was that she'd allow a vote on you know, a second referendum or a people's vote or a financial referendum, whatever you want to call it. But you know, the reality is, you know, that was worthless because people like myself and other colleagues who firmly believe that the only way out of this mess now is really to go back to the people would have been able to present an amendment anyway. So the key thing was, what was the government's position? There's no change in the government's position on the issue. But I think,
but you're now in a position, Jonathan, and correct me if I'm wrong, but say we have a hard Brexiteer elected as Conservative leader who becomes Prime Minister and is quite happy to see Britain leaving the EU with no deal. All he or she has to do is let the clock tick, not give MPs an opportunity to vote in any meaningful way on the issue, and there's nothing you can do to stop a no-deal Brexit.
No. Well, first of all, there's no mandate for no deal in any shape or form.
Doesn't matter. So, doesn't matter if the Prime Minister is the Prime Minister.
It does matter, of course, because the way the British political system works is that you only remain Prime Minister as long as you've got the confidence of the House of Commons. And I would imagine if a new Tory leader were to come in and say, right, I'm going for no deal, I don't care what anybody thinks, then they won't be in command of a parliamentary majority for a very long time.
But you're then banking, Jonathan, aren't you? You're banking on some, not only wouldn't it take that many, but some Conservative MPs being prepared to take the risk, as they would see it, of Jeremy Corbyn in number 10 in order to prevent a no-deal Brexit. And, you know, I know there are people who feel very strongly about a no-deal Brexit, but that's a heck of a big ask, isn't it?
Well, I don't particularly think so. I think, the reality, Vaughan, is that it's not just Parliament that's polarised. I think, you know, what's happening in the House of Commons, it reflects what's happening in the country. Because what tends to happen after a referendum is that people coalesce around the winning side. That just has happened. And the middle ground is hollow. Now, the first day after the referendum, I was saying I'd be quite happy to support a compromise situation, which meant staying within the single market and the customs union, very much what Stephen's been arguing for. And indeed, I voted for those options whenever they've been presented to the House of Commons over the last 3 years. But the reality is that people out there aren't particularly interested in the middle ground. They're either, if anything, there's more of a move towards staying within the European Union. And of course, that's then reflected in terms of how members of Parliament have acted within the House of Commons. So the reality is the only way now to get out of this mess. I think you know what's likely to happen tonight. The Tories will panic after the result. You're right to in your analysis that it's going to be a beauty parade for hard Brexiteers, as Justine Greening puts it. But then it becomes then the stark choice, doesn't it, between revoking Article 15, remaining within the European Union, or going for a no-deal Brexit, which wasn't on the option paper in 2016 in any shape or form. Nobody was talking about that. It's a nonsensical position for all sorts of reasons. And you will have to legitimise that choice. And therefore, that means we have to go back to the people in a final say referendum. That is the only way out of this mess. Otherwise, the British state faces years and years and years of political turmoil.
Well, let me put that to Steve Kinnock, if I may, Stephen. How do we get back to normal politics? Because, you know, people out there, they're worried about jobs, they're worried about public services, they're worried about the health service. They have day-to-day worries, and Parliament is involved in this psychodrama around about Europe. And no one seems to know how we get back to discussing the political issues that matter in people's everyday lives.
Well, I think there's a technical and constitutional answer to that, which is we've got to resolve this Brexit issue one way or another. I personally think now the most likely outcome is we're going to crash out of the European without a deal. And I think I just don't know how long the United Kingdom's economy can survive that. So I think in one way or the other, whoever the Prime Minister is would have to go back to Brussels and get some sort of deal which resolves the issue. The other way is to have a second referendum. My view is if we have that immediately, the Brexit Party and all the leavers will be up asking for best out of three. So I think we need a solution which resolves the issue as quickly as possible. By far the best solution is to leave the EU with a deal that protects the British economy.
That's more or less out of the window now, isn't it? Because the EU says they're not willing to renegotiate the withdrawal deal they had with Theresa May, and that's not going to pass, is it?
Well, the motion of no confidence and a general election is the other option, but the clock is ticking on that. The Tories will elect their new leader at the end of July. That new leader will be given a chance to go back to Brussels. There'll be some sort of charade about trying to make them drop the backstop. That's never going to happen. By that stage, it's too late to have a general election. You crash out on the 31st of October. But one way or the other, we need a change of mentality in Parliament. I'm afraid that there's been a conspiracy, accidental, but nevertheless it's happened, of second referendum campaigners and no dealers who have pulled the discussion to the two extremes in Parliament, and a democracy cannot survive unless it's ready to compromise. A society can't be coherent unless it's ready to compromise. British politics has to rediscover the lost art of compromise.
Is the British state in danger then, Stephen? Is the union in danger? I mean, you see, you're talking about the economic consequences, the fact that our political system seems broken. Is the result of Brexit, if you like, an existential question about the future of the UK?
Absolutely. It's a question about the future of our democracy, but it's about the future of the union, because I think if there's a hard Brexit and you start seeing infrastructure being put on the Irish border and a return to the violence, you will have a border poll in Ireland, in Northern Ireland, within a matter of years. And I think then we would then see there's a very high chance of the reunification of Ireland. And, you know, I'm a unionist. I believe passionately in our union. And I think that Brexit is putting that seriously in danger.
Stephen Kinnock, Jonathan Edwards, thank you both very much indeed.